So we have been going through the book Luke and the Bible studies you guys have been a part of, as well as in teachings. So let's just start with the text that we'll be looking at from Luke tonight. Jesus said, "Why do you keep calling me Lord, Lord, when you don't do what I say? Someone comes to me, listens to my teaching, and then follows it. And that is like a person building a house who digs deep and lays the foundation on solid rock. When the floodwaters rise and break against the house, it stands firm because it's well built. But anyone who hears and doesn't obey is like a person who builds a house without a foundation right on the ground. When the floods sweep down against that house, it will collapse into a heap of ruins." So I set this up somewhat intentionally. You see there are words that are made a little more visible to see that these are being contrasted in what Jesus is saying. We'll get into that, but you have ones that come, listen, and follow, and then you have those that simply hear and don't obey. If you come, listen, and follow, that's like a solid rock, and if you just hear but you don't obey, that's just like building your house on the ground. So, the introduction to parables, because what this is a parable that Jesus is telling. Parables in general. In the Western tradition, we often think that like real theology or real philosophy, it's held up mostly by like the ideas of logic. And not so much based upon story, but like, we just go like, if you can have these ideas, we build logic, and that's how we do it. Now the Apostle Paul, one of the biblical writers, he works a lot with ideas and with metaphors. And in the text, we tended that we emphasize his concepts. We emphasize these ideas like justification, the redemption, that we use these things. But then his metaphors, they're kind of nice, but they're not as important. As we see, but we'll put concepts over metaphors often. But Jesus, as a teacher, he was a metaphorical theologian. He was someone who used metaphors very, very often. And he created meaning out of these, much like a dramatist would or a poet. So instead of being like a philosopher that's just giving you these concepts, Jesus is a storyteller. So if for Jesus, stories and dramatic actions are sort of his language of theology, then his culture is crucial. The culture in which a story is told makes a really big difference. So when we come to the Bible, it's good for us to get some of the culture in it. Now, anyone can read the Bible and get things out of it and be blessed by it, and that can be good. But someone said, it's sort of like anyone can listen to this great piece of music by Beethoven or Mozart, and they can be moved by it and really enjoy it. But the more that you learn about how music works, if you listen to that same piece, you have a deeper understanding of it, you have a deeper appreciation of it, you can pick out more of it, and it can probably move you on a deeper level if you're trained to pay attention to it. And the same with the Bible, that yes, people can get things out of it. That's why I put the first thing in black and white, because it's pretty black and white the way Jesus says it. But it's helpful to be able to like, hear it on this deeper level by getting some of the cultural things. But before we get to the culture, let's start with my own culture. So, my life, when I was a kid, my parents, we moved into a house, the house that I lived in for about 12 years, which is the longest I've lived in every house of my life. And they said that we could put a mural on our wall. So we went to the store and my brother and I could pick murals. So this was my room. What I would come to every day, what I'd fall asleep looking at, is seeing the beach. It makes perfect sense that I ended up living in the Caribbean, working there for 2.5 years, like the beach. And my brother, he chose like this mountainscape. So you walk into my room, it's nice and warm, it's nice and cozy. You walk into his and it's like cold. But yeah, I now live in the Netherlands. That has no mountains. So it kind of makes sense for a house of this work together. So often when we look at this story, this parable of Jesus, well, there's one guy who builds his house on the sand, there's one guy who builds his house on the rock, and we think that it's like that. There's a man who chooses to have a beach house, and there's somebody who's like this mountain man that builds his house way up on a hill. This is often our view of the parable. You have rock, you have sand, you have the genius who builds his house on a rock, and then you have the idiot who's like, well, of course, you're going to have your house destroyed because you chose to live on a beach. What do you think? So that's our common conception of how this stories that come across. But that also comes somewhat from the book of Matthew, because in these biographies of Jesus, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we have the same story in Matthew that we have in Luke, although Luke says it a little clearer, that it tells us this next picture is actually a better understanding of what Jesus is talking about. It's not that there's some guy who built his house on sand and some guy who had his house that was up on like a mountain nest somewhere. Instead, in Israel, especially at the time, solid rock is everywhere. It's just down. It's beneath everything. It's beneath the soil. So the depth that a person would have to excavate to construct a stone house, if you wanted to build your house, if you ask people today, well, what do you have to do to build a house? How deep do you have to go? They would say, well, down to the rock. And whether that's this far down to the rock or it's 10 meters down to the rock, you go down to the rock because that's what's going to be a settled thing to be able to build your house upon. So we have these two men. One of them builds his house just on sand. He doesn't actually care to dig down. And then there's the other man who actually does dig down. Okay, so the catastrophic results of not building your house correctly. So this was back in 2009 in Shanghai, China. The Lotus Riverside Block 7 fell over after there was some rain. Only one man died because of this. You can tell this is the one that has fallen over. Now, the amazing thing about it was that it was almost completely intact. Even most of the glass that was in the windows did not break. They just showed up in the morning, and it was no longer standing up straight. And this was because they had made a radical error in the foundation and what they were doing, and so they were taking too much out on one side, too much from one side, and then adding dirt on this other side, and then it rained, and that caused it to shift to a degree. So it just snapped off and just fell over. Only one person died from it, thankfully, but still, one person died because of drastic stupidity. And even though this looks very nice, it apparently was built incredibly well to stay together. Do you build everything else good? Screw up the foundation, it's not going to be worth anything. That's one of the problems that we have. And there are plenty of times where that was a problem. So I was looking up, I was trying to do some research to find out just how many buildings have bad foundations that lead to problems. And they said, like, of the top five reasons of why a place collapses, that was one of those five. I think it was number three. It was most often something is wrong with the foundation. In August 1991, a third of an apartment complex in the Jerusalem suburb of Talpiot just collapsed. And there were 28 families that were forced to evacuate. No one died, thankfully. But the reason why it collapsed, they discovered, was that a sewer line was leaking water under the part that collapsed, and that it had been built on loose soil, not on the bedrock, as is accepted practice. So even today, people understand this idea. You need to put your house on a rock. You dig down it as necessary to be able to reach rock, because otherwise it's not going to go well. You're going to look like an idiot, and that will be posted on YouTube and Facebook one season. Okay, so that's some of that background part, but I said that the culture is really important. So Jesus is making Old Testament and cultural connections with the parable that he's giving, that when he says this, it's not just in sort of a vacuum, but he's saying this to people who would, they would pick up on the hints, or they would recognize sort of the cultural things that he's saying. See, Jesus knew the Old Testament well. When we look through his life and we see these various things, if you know what you're looking for, or if you have an understanding of it, so often he is quoting and quoting and quoting things from the Old Testament. And that's not simply because, oh, well, he's God, he must know everything about it. When he's doing it, that means he expects that his hearers are also knowing what he's doing much of the time. I'll give just one quick example. When Jesus is on the cross, he makes this statement, my God, why have you forsaken me? Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. A lot of people ask, why did he do that? And I think there are several reasons of why that is. But did you know that's a quote taken directly from one of the Psalms? Psalms 22, verse 1, starts that way. My God, why have you forsaken me? Jesus has it so much into his heart and mind that even when he's suffering and dying, the poetry of the Bible is coming back to his mind and heart. That's why I encourage you, memorize the Bible. Memorize these things, because in those moments when it's hard to think about anything else, what you have memorized is what's easiest to hold on to sometimes. So Jesus did this often, and he's doing that here. He seems to draw largely from Isaiah 28, verse 14 to 17. God is speaking through a prophet, or speaking through a prophet. He says, this is what the Lord says. He says, there are people in Jerusalem who said, we struck a bargain to cheat death and made a deal to dodge the grave, and the coming destruction can never touch us. Therefore, this is what the Sovereign Lord says. Look, I am placing a foundation stone in Jerusalem, a firm, tested stone. It's a precious cornerstone that's safe to build on. Whoever believes need never be shaken. I will test you with the measuring line of justice, plumb line of righteousness. And since your refuge is made of lies, a hailstorm will knock it down. Since it's made of deception, a flood will sweep it away. Now, it's not word for word the exact same thing, but we have God is speaking, just like we had Jesus speaking. I lay a foundation. There's a stone. It's a cornerstone. You build on it. If you rely on it, you won't be shaken. Does that sound familiar? That, hear my words, you do it, it'll be like a house that's built on a foundation. And when things come against it, it won't be destroyed. But since you've made your refuge lies, hailstorm will knock it down, and since it's deception, a flood will sweep it away. He doesn't say sandy soil, but he says, if you're not on this foundation, floods will knock it over. Jesus is very, very clearly making a connection to that. The other thing that Jesus seems to be making a connection to is not solely this place in Isaiah, but then also in Ezekiel chapter 33, verse 29 to 33. Once again, God is speaking to a prophet. He tells them that he's going to destroy the land because of their sins. Then they'll know that he's the Lord. He says, son of man, talk about you in their houses. So, house, that's similar. They talk about you in their houses and whisper about you at their doors, and they say to each other, ooh, come on, let's go hear the prophet. Tell us what the Lord is saying. So my people come pretending to be sincere and sit before you. They listen to your words, but they have no intention of doing what you say. Their mouths are full of lustful words. Their hearts seek only after money. You're very entertaining to them, like someone who sings love songs with a beautiful voice or plays fine music on an instrument. They hear what you say, but they don't act on it. But when all these terrible things do happen to them, as they certainly will, then they'll know their prophet has been among them. So he doesn't say too much about the house that's going on, but he says, okay, people who hear my words but don't do what I say, it's going to end poorly for them. So this is what's said in Ezekiel. Jesus kind of makes this connection between both the Isaiah reference and the Ezekiel reference. And as I read it, it caught me, this whole, like, you're very entertaining to them. God tells his prophet, you're entertaining to them. You're sort of like someone who sings love songs that they just enjoy listening to. Jesus better be more to you than Taylor Swift, or Sam Smith, or Ed Sheeran. But here's the thing, right? Jesus says, if you hear my words and you obey them, if you hear them, you probably need to know them, right? Now, how many of you can quote an Ed Sheeran song or a Taylor Swift song, and then compare that with how much you could quote something that Jesus said? And it could be a different artist. If you think both of those are lame, I'm okay with that fact, actually. If you have, well, like, who's, are there other things that you memorize? So many times people are like, oh, it's really hard to memorize the Bible. Like, oh, I'm not good at memorizing. There's tons of stuff you memorize. Tons of stuff you memorize. You just don't always realize it. If you do, and you can do the same thing with the Bible. That's why I'm working on my son memorizing some stuff, and we just put in a song. And some other people have like written songs that are like Bible verses in song form. So I just play it for my son, because then he'll learn it without even necessarily knowing it, but that would be something that's on his heart. Because I want him to know these words. I don't just want him to be entertained by them, but I want him to be able to put it into practice. And that's the other part. We do that with music too, right? Like, oh, I listen to it, but it's not like I do any of those things. So back years ago, when Eminem wins a Grammy for an album that has, direct songs about a man abusing and murdering his wife and kid, and then that's celebrated. The people are just like, oh, I'm gonna listen to music, it's not like actually, I'm not gonna do it. Yeah, great for you, that's brilliant. Last I saw, this was about 2 weeks ago, the reason why I mentioned Ed Sheeran is because one of his songs is on the top of the Dutch radio charts, pretty much says, I'm in love with your body. My heart might be falling for you too, but I'm in love with your body. Seriously, that's the best we can do? That's the highest that's going on? And yet, people are like, oh, well, it's not like I do any of that. I just listen to music. And it's probably just as stupid to say it that way as it is with Jesus, where it's like, yeah, you know, I hear some of the Bible. I just don't do what it says. Why are you wasting your time listening to it? Either way, why would you waste your time listening to the Bible if you have no intention of actually doing what it says? Okay, moving on. So I used to have a job pouring concrete. Pretty nice, right? Yeah. So I was preparing for being a pastor. Since the Apostle Paul also said that he was a skilled master builder, that's me back in the day. In Israel or in the Palestine villages, they would only be able to build during the summer. So again, we're going back to the story. Jesus is talking about building. And during the winter, because it's wet, it's really hard to actually build on stuff because that's not the good time to do it, plus it's just colder. So they're going to build during the summer. Summer provides the dry, the warm days to build houses. But there is a downside because then that makes it really hard soil. In the book of Leviticus, he talks about the soil and saying that because of its high clay content, it's like bronze, is the way that they use. If you've ever tried to drive a shovel into really clayey soil, which Missouri is, the place where I grew up, it is a pain to go through, and that's what they have. When we look at today, and I'll tell you a bit about my work, but if we look back at their time frame, for King Solomon to build his temple, which was 1,800 square feet, it took him 7 years to build one building. When King Herod built his temple, it took him 46 years to build that. Compare that to the really slow process of building the A2 tunnel that they're still working on. But that didn't take 46 years. We have digging machines now to get us through stuff, and we have so much that allows us to do so much work so much faster. We have cranes, we have all these things, and as we're driving by, Dave's like, aha, machina! Because he loves digging machines. Now we have the ability to do this stuff, but for them, it would have taken a long time. And if you're building your house, to be able to dig down all the way to get to wherever the bedrock is, that could take months and months before you actually get to doing any work. All you're doing is trying the day. Now, when I worked pouring concrete, that was when you show up on a site, the first thing is you have to dig out the spots so that you'll pour first the foundation, and then you pour the floors on top of that, and then you have all these other things. I remember some of the times when I'm like, do we really have to dig any further? Like, we're supposed to get it down like this far, but we're like that far. I'm like, it's not really that. Really? Or like, it's supposed to be nice and straight, like you got like the square thing going on, but sometimes just to get that straight edge, it's a lot easier to just have the bowl. And my boss is the kind of guy who's like, no, that's not good. It has to be good, because we're not going to screw up this foundation, right? We've already seen catastrophic results, and if you don't get the foundation right, and like, oh, but it's hot today, I don't care. Oh, but the soil is hard. Doesn't matter. What we need to do is actually be able to build down, to work on it. My previous boss was also, he was just kind of a hard man. He's the one boss who's like, hit me upside the head as well. He's very concerned about what he does, but that makes him pretty good at making these foundations. So as I remember pretty much all times when a concrete truck would come up, because he would hire other guys to send a concrete truck in. So we'd do all the work, and then they bring the concrete truck, and he has to look in, he's like sticking his head in this concrete mixer. So you have the huge like mixing thing, that's the big concrete truck. And he's looking in to see if the concrete is good enough to pour, because if there's not enough water in it, or if it's too watery, it's gonna make a bad foundation. And he would swear and chew upside and down the other, the guys who are running these trucks, if he didn't think it was good enough. And he sent some of them back. They're carrying tons of concrete. He's like, this is not good enough. You have to go back and send me another one. And I need it here in 30 minutes because we can't just pour part of this and not the rest of it. And he's the kind of guy you didn't want to say no to. So my hard-nosed boss is really concerned about the quality of what we're putting into the foundation, especially. Now, when Jesus talks about the foundation of your life, are you concerned about the quality of what you know and what you do? This is going to be like the eventual question. Do you care about the foundation that you're building on? And Jesus says, okay, here's the good foundation, right? The people who know my words and who put them into practice. How well do you know Jesus' word? We're going to have a 3-question quiz right now. You can answer for yourself. That will at least give me a good start on whether, how you're doing with this. I'm knowing what Jesus said. One time, Jesus says, the first and greatest commandment is to, could you finish that sentence? The first and greatest commandment is to.
Yeah. Love the Lord with all your mind.
Can we get a little more clarity on that?
Love the Lord with all your heart and all your mind and all your soul.
That's not the first one. Heart and soul.
Heart and mind is definitely in it.
Heart and mind is definitely in that.
Soul.
That's the first one.
That's the second one.
Yes. Okay, so love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and strength. Now, some of them have different things within it, so all four of those are used in various parts. Heart, soul, and mind, I think, is what's used in Deuteronomy 6, which is where Jesus gets this from. It's taken from the Lord. First and greatest commandment, so love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength. Okay, question number 2. He says the second is like it. What is the second greatest commandment that Jesus gives? Somebody here said this, but can you answer for yourself? Okay. Love your
neighbor.
Okay, so you got 2 down. Here's the 3rd one. Jesus said, a new command I give to you. What is his new command? See, this is what gets me. Sometimes people remember the greatest and the second. But when Jesus says, a new commandment I give to you, like he's saying, this is a commandment. Shouldn't it be something that we know that we know? That we're sure that we know? That it's not just like... It's probably, like he says, this is a commandment. Like, is this not important? If he says, those who hear my words and put them into practice are those who are building their house on a good foundation, and those who hear my words and don't do what it says, it's not going to end well for them, then shouldn't something like a new commandment I give you, which he says twice, should that not be something that you know? Honestly, that should be a really easy 3-question survey. That's not even getting into some of the other stuff he says. Do you care about the foundation that you're building your life on? You want to know the answer?
Yeah.
Yes.
What was it?
As I have loved you, so you must love one another, or love one another as I have loved you. He says in John 13, and in John 15 he says the same thing. Yeah. New commandment, I give you, love one another as I have loved you. Here's the amazing thing, right? So the commandments are to love, and if you love him, you'll obey his commandments. That's another thing that he says, that's a good one to remember. Like, if you love me, you will obey my commands. Well, you have to know what they are, because you know that you know what those are. There's tons of other things that he talks about. So, how do we know that we're building our foundation on the rock? How do we know that we're doing that? Well, by hearing and doing. And what is it that we're supposed to be doing? So Jesus said this thing about, okay, here's the foundation at the end of Luke 6 and also at the end of Matthew 7. And those are both at the end of these sermons, sometimes called Sermon on the Mount or the Sermon on the Plain for Matthew 5 through 7 and Luke 6. So here's some of the things that he says. These are not a good foundation. Here are some of the things that he says are a good foundation. So, not a sturdy foundation. Riches. Woe to those who are rich, he says. Comfort. Says, woe to those who are happy now, to those who laugh now, because you've received your comfort already. Says, yeah, you've heard it said, well, don't be angry. Well, also, don't call your brother a fool. He says, don't hold lust in your heart. He says, don't judge and don't live your life by comparisons. Don't go up to the other person and be like, oh, let me look at the speck in your eye when you've got this flipping log coming out of your own eye. So he says, comparisons, that's not a good way to live your life. That's shaky foundation. How many of you know that? Can you always say that's true? Like, living your life, comparing yourself to other people, that's not very sturdy. Because I come across this person, and I'll look like I'm awesome. You'll be like, oh, someone's better than that person. And then I come across this person, I look like a moron. And it's always based upon who you're around. It's not a sturdy foundation. Judging people, he says, if you judge, it's going to be returned to you in that way. People pleasing, he says, don't be running after what other people are desiring. He says, that's not the way to live your life. That's not going to be a foundation. He says, do not worry, do not seek revenge. Instead, pray for those who persecute you, love your enemies, and don't use deception. Okay, so Matthew 5 to 7 and Luke chapter 6, those would also be really good things if you want to know what Jesus is saying. Like, these are some things that I highly recommend. Read, reread, and if you can memorize part of them, hey, go for it. Now, good step. If you've ever learned the Lord's Prayer already, then you've memorized part of Matthew chapter 6, so you're already on your way. But I would recommend learning more about it. Some of the things that he says, blessed are those who are poor, blessed are those who hunger, blessed are those who mourn, blessed are those who are meek, blessed are those who are pure in heart. He goes to these people who are needy, and he says, you know what, being in need of God is actually a good foundation to start on. He says, blessed are you when you're persecuted, when people hate you, when people say all kinds of mean things about you for my sake. So it's not just like, you're a jerk, I hate you. Like, if you're being a jerk, he's not saying you're blessed for being a jerk. But those, and I've met people who have truly been persecuted for their faith. People who have lost family members because of their faith. People who've had others kidnapped because of their faith. Those who are persecuted for Jesus' name, I would say, what he offers is worth more to me than anything that can be taken away. He says that's part of being on a good foundation, and we study in that. Reconciliation. Jesus talks about forgiveness in these areas. He says, like, okay, go try to be reconciled to people instead of just going into a church service and being like, everything's good with me, I love Jesus. That person hates me, but I love Jesus. No, be reconciled. That's part of a good foundation. Love. Love your enemies, love other people, generosity, give, prayer, and fasting. All three of those, where he says, like, when you pray, he's not saying, oh, well, hopefully you'll pray, that'll be a good thing. He's like, no, that should be a part of your life. When you pray, when you fast, when you give, don't do it for other people to see it. And that's part of the whole, like, people-pleasing thing, where he's saying, like, that's not a firm foundation. If you try to look like you're spiritual, that way other people like you, that's not really what it's about. It's what's really going on inside of your heart. But we should be generous. We should pray. We should fast, but from these right motives. Simple honesty. At the time, like, you probably know people who, when they're telling you a lie, they'll try to sound especially truthful, or they'll try to, like, say, are you sure? Yes, of course, I would never lie to you, and didn't I do this, and I swear on my mother and father's grave, and on my pendant that I got from my grandma. Like, the more that they try to convince you, the more fake it sounds. Jesus says, don't make oaths on things. Don't swear by this or that or by the temple or the gold in the temple. He says, just let your yes be yes. Let your no be no. Just a simple honesty. And then prioritizing. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. All these other things will be added to you. Don't worry about what you eat or what you drink, or don't worry about what you wear, for your heavenly Father knows you need these things. And if he can take care of the flowers of the field that are here today and gone tomorrow, but these flowers, they're dressed better than the most wealthy king that we had in our nation's history. Or if the birds, if they get to eat, they're not long lifespan as ours. Don't you know that God will take care of you? Have your priorities straight. These are some of the concrete, observable actions or some of the attitudes that can be indicators of whether we're basing our lives on Jesus' words or not. And yes, we should believe. And we push that a lot in church. It's like, oh, well, you need to believe, you need to believe, but belief can't be divorced from action, right? Jesus is saying, here are things that you should do. In Matthew 5 through 7, actually it's in Matthew chapter 7, is what's often called the golden rule, right? Do to others what you would have them do to you. Now, I've never heard someone who tried to say, Jesus just meant that in a spiritual way. He just wants you to do that in your heart. He's not meaning to actually do anything to others. He just wants you to inside. No, Jesus expects physical actions. He expects us to walk in that. And still, yes, the heart is the most important thing, because also in these verses he talks about what comes out of the heart is what's going to come out from the mouth, right? Out of the overflow of the heart is what the mouth speaks. So the heart still plays a very central role, but your heart's going to lead what you do in your actions. So I'm not trying to say that our salvation or our standing at the final judgment is based upon our works. And yet, we really should take this warning seriously. When Jesus says, the people who hear my word but don't do it, it's like this house that's going to get destroyed and the destruction is complete. So we'll do a quick look at the word salvation and to be saved. We're told in Hebrews chapter 5 that Jesus is the author of our salvation. So Jesus is the one who does it. Yet, in Hebrews chapter 6, the very next verse, we're told that we should produce things in our life that accompany salvation. So Jesus is the author, but that there's production that comes out from it. We're told that we're kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation. That's in 1 Peter 1. And that the scriptures make us wise to salvation. That's 2 Timothy 3. At the same time, those scriptures tell us that we should work out our salvation. Philippians chapter 2. So all of those use the same word for salvation. It says this is something that God does, and yet it's something that we walk in as well. The Greek word sozo that's used for saved, we're told that we are sozo, we are saved by grace through faith. That's Ephesians chapter 2. But we're still called to be people who are building on the salvation. Consider 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 10 to 15, which is another nice story about a building. So Paul has said, I am one by the grace God has given me that I'm building like a skilled master builder. I've laid a foundation and someone else is building on it. Now, each builder must choose with care how to build on that foundation. For no one can lay any foundation other than the one that's been laid. The foundation is Jesus Christ, which we've already somewhat spoken of. It says, now if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, stones, wood, hay, straw, the work of each builder will become visible, for the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed with fire. And the fire will test what sort of work each has done. If what has been built on the foundation survives, the builder will receive a reward. If the work is burned up, the builder will suffer loss. The builder will be saved, but only as through fire. So again, something is being built. Again, Jesus is based in the foundation. And again, there's the destructive element. Paul is probably drawing a little bit from what Jesus said in chapter 6 for this image, except now the destructive element, instead of being water rushing through, is fire that's just going to burn things down. And that was really fun, making the whole, like, building with fire, I gotta say. Okay. Does anyone know Trogdor the Burninator? Trogdor is a dragon that burns things. It's completely unnecessary. Except that that was my inspiration for burning this house down. So we have all those things, and the word for saved that was used in Ephesians 2, that we're saved by grace through faith, is the same word that then gets used here, that he will be saved, but through fire. And everything that they did, all of the other work that was built on top of it, is lost. That's not the way that we want to end up. So, what's the conclusion? What are we supposed to make of all this? Sometimes people have this distinction of looking for, okay, saved or unsaved, and that's, if you're just looking for that, like, oh, am I saved or am I not saved, that's not the distinction I think we should be looking at. We should be looking at the distinction that Jesus made. And if the word picture is throwing off of a building or not, you don't need necessarily the word picture, just Jesus made a people distinction that doesn't need word pictures. He says, there are people who hear my words and do them. He said, there are people who hear my words and don't do them. Which one are you? That is his question. Which one are you going to be? Jesus obviously recommends that we be part of that first group. Those who not only hear, but who do it. Now, some people would be like, well, if I just don't hear it, does that mean that I'll get away with it? I never heard it, so I can't get in trouble. Well, too late. You've already heard some of his words anyway. You hear his word more often than you realize. The Bible's actually in a lot more cultural references than you know. So my simple encouragements to you. Number one, listen to what Jesus says because he knows what he's talking about. When he talks about life, like, he has a pretty good understanding of how it works. So you see through the stories, he's just incredible at how he interacts with people, what he understands about people, and how I see that played out today in examples in current day life, just like 2,000 years ago. I think Jesus is this wise, incredible man. I am astounded by him often. So I was like, oh, it's Jesus, I gotta do this. But I love studying. I love learning about it. So number one, listen to what Jesus says because he knows what he's talking about. Number two, do what Jesus says because he knows what he's talking about. You just listen to him, but you don't do it. Like, what he's talking about is this is how we can act. This is how we can live out what God's kingdom is like. Do you care about your foundation? Do you care about what's on top of your foundation? Maybe an easier question for you to answer. Do you spend more time working on what's visible or what's invisible in your life? Like, do you spend more time working on what everyone else sees? Or do you work on what's underneath the surface? Because here's the hard truth. No one else cares about your foundation until it breaks and you have a major breakdown. It's just like a whole lot of buildings that we go around. When I go to Rotterdam, which is one of the, by my wife said, ugliest cities in the Netherlands. Actually, she doesn't say one of. She says that is the ugliest city. And she was born there, so she feels like it's okay for her to make fun of it. When I go there and I look at some of the architecture, I'm like, I don't necessarily like this. I don't think for a moment, like, that must have an incredible foundation. Wow, that must be really strong. They know what they're doing. I don't care. Let's go, that looks ugly. Why did you do that? Some of the things aren't, like, I'm not, but I mean, have you ever seen a building? We care about what's on top. We care about what's on the outside. We do that with people so often. We care about what they look like for the 15 minutes that we're interacting in front, but we're not really thinking about what the foundation is like. I wonder when something bad happens in their life, how sturdy are they going to be? When they go home and they're alone and there's no one else inside of the apartment, what are they really like? Most of us don't take the time to stop and think about it. And honestly, we don't always stop to think about that in our own lives either. But if you want to have a strong foundation, you're going to have to be the one who cares about it. Because I can't build it for you. Your mom and dad can help with some things, but they can't really build that foundation for you. Eventually, it becomes your own responsibility. How are you building? What is it that you're doing with that? And please don't wait on that. When I look back in my own life and I think about it, probably the most effort that I put in was between the age of 15 and 22. Those were the years that I grew the most. 15 is when I decided to start following after Jesus. And I didn't do it because I wanted to be a pastor, because I never wanted to be a pastor. And I didn't do it because anyone else was making me. It was because I wanted to grow, because I wanted to learn. I memorized a book of the Bible because I felt like God wanted me to do it, but I was like, this, I want to have this in my heart, and I want to learn this, and I want to study this. As an 18-year-old kid who doesn't get credit for anything else, and no one is going around like, oh, look at you, what you know. I don't need to. People-pleasing, that's not a solid foundation anyway. But I am thankful that God caught my heart while I was young enough that I would put my attention and my time into it, and I'd work hard on it. And it's not... So often I hear people like, oh, when I get older. No, don't wait till you get older. Oh, when I'm 40, I'm going to start. No, you're not. It's just like learning a language, right? I mean, when we go like, oh, well, I'm going to start, I'll do that when I'm older. I'll do that when I have kids. Oh my gosh, no. As someone who has kids, please let me tell you, it's so much easier to spend time with God before you have children that are young. Not saying that there's not incredible things to learn, but it's not easier the older that you get. You don't feel like you have more time the older that you get. And if you're waiting until you're 65, you're probably going to think, man, there's so much time that I could have used otherwise. Don't wait to build your foundation, because when you already start building all the stuff on top, it's really hard to get back down to the foundation. If you've ever started putting together like IKEA furniture and you're not following the directions or you think you are, but you find out that you missed a step, you can't just automatically like, oh, well, I'll just go put that in now. You gotta like break down some junk just to be able to get to it. It's so frustrating and I don't like it. But it's true, and it's a good picture of life. It's like a parable that I've lived out where God says to me, like, your life is like IKEA. Like an IKEA closet, not like IKEA. But if you build it up wrong to start with, it's going to be really hard to unbuild it. It's going to take time, and you can't just like, oh, let's rent a foundation to throw it under here. No, this is your good chance. Build a good foundation now. And there'll be people who are really grateful for that. And some that they won't even realize that they're grateful for it, but it'll be good for them. If you end up getting married to somebody, trust me, it'll be good if you had a good foundation before you got to that point. And that husband or that wife may never know what would have been the difference if you hadn't worked on that foundation, but it will show up and there will be cracks that get in if you haven't built a good foundation. Your kids? It'll make a difference whether you had a good foundation or not. Your boss, the people that you work with, the people that God wants you to touch their lives, if you don't have a good foundation, it will make a difference. I was talking with a friend last night, and she was telling me these stories of like all these pastors who have done crazy, stupid junk that ended up getting them like divorced and out of ministry and doing everything else where, because of drinking problems, because of womanizing problems, because of all these other things, they didn't have a foundation that had integrity, like those things that Jesus talked about, Matthew 5 and 7 and Luke 6. And because they didn't do that, they looked really good on the outside, and people loved them for a while. And you can walk around inside the house and be like, oh, wow, this is a beautiful, I love the windows you have, those are wonderful curtains, those are over there. Oh, that table, that's really great. And oh, you have a urinal? I've always wanted one of those in my house. Because I'm a man, I want to be able to stand up without having to look to see. But this is a great house that you have. But then, when the foundation goes up, and all the people who are walking around inside that house fall in, they don't care how nice it looked before. Just like, it doesn't matter how strong that building was, it just... may have looked great the day before, standing next to block 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. But when block 7 fell over, people stopped caring about anything except the foundation. Do you care about the foundation? Do you care enough to work on it now?